Hello dear students, I am Ramavatar Meena. Welcome to today's class. Today we will be read second chapter of history from trade to territory. In this chapter we will read how the British came to trade in India and how they gradually established an empire here. Dear students, you can see these two pictures. In the first picture describe Raja or ruler sitting with his many minister or nobles around him, but Englishman standing in front of him. But in the second picture, the Englishman is seated and the Raja stand with folded hands around it. So what happened here that Raja such as higher post is now standing around the British with folding hands? So let us now through this chapter how such a big change came. Dear students, Babur was the first Mughal ruler in India from 1526 to 1530. After that, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Aurangzeb, Bahadur Shah Zafar rulers came in India. But Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal rulers from 1658 to 1707. Keep your mind, dear students, Bahadur Shah Zafar was the last Mughal rulers but not powerful Mughal rulers. After Aurangzeb's death in 1707, many Mughals, governors, subedars and big zamindars began establishing their own regional kingdoms. This led to downfall of Delhi as an effective center, thus creating political stability. East India Company comes east. In 1600, the East India Company acquired a charter from the ruler of England, Queen Elizabeth I, granting it the sole right to trade with the East. Dear student, charter means right order and sole right means it should be only their authority. The British had come from Europe to trade in India through this sea route. Elizabeth I was Queen of England and Ireland from 1558 to 1603. Next, how was the charter important for East India Company? East India Company could venture across the ocean towards the east, looking for new lands to trade with, and East India Company did not have to fear competition from other English trading companies. East India Company bought goods at a cheap price and sold them at higher price in Europe. East India Company and its officials accumulated wealth by the trade of India and caught attention of other European powers. English East India Company had to compete with other European companies such as French, Dutch and Portuguese. Because of the powerful naval force, British won other European powers and became the champion of struggle of monotony of trade. Dear student, other trading companies in India, Portuguese, French, Dutch, English. First, Vasco da Gama discovered sea route to India in 1498 in Calicut. Vasco da Gama, initial voyage to India, was the first to link Europe and Asia by an ocean route connecting the Atlantic and the Indian Oceans, and therefore the West and the Orient and Europe to India. This route, main reasons to trade with India. Cotton and silk produce in India had a big market in Europe, and some fabric crops, fine quality of cottons and silk, but some spices, peppers, clove, cardamom and cinnamon. Dear student, all spices and fabrics are important for Europe, but after that some measures taken by East India Company to establish their sole right over trading with India.
first fighting battles with other companies and Indian Rajas, sinking each other's ships and blocking routes, preventing rival ships from moving out with supplies of goods, fortifying the trading post. Dear student, fortifying means started building huge walls across the port cities, means big walls make nearby sea.
In this way, the East India Company defeated all the other European companies and drove away from here, and then started doing trade only in India. East India Company begins trade in Bengal. In 1651, the first English factory was set up on the bank of River Hooghly. Dear student, Hooghly River nearby Kolkata. And first English factory was opened up at Surat in 1608. This was the base from which the company's traders, known at that time as factors, operated. The factory had a warehouse where goods for export were stored, and it had offices where company officials sat. As trade expanded, the company persuaded merchant and traders to come and settle near the factory. By 1696, it began building a fort around the settlement. Company bribes the Mughal officials and acquired zamindari rights over three villages. One of this was Kalikata, later known as Calcutta and Kolkata. Dear students, the company tried continuously to press for more concession and manipulate exciting privileges. Aurangzeb Farman, for instance, had granted only the company the right to trade duty free, but officials of the company and officers of the company who were carrying on private trade on the side were expected to pay duty. Dear student, it also pursued Aurangzeb to issue a farman granting the company to trade duty free. Dear student, in this picture, local boats bring goods from ships in Madras. So now, Aurangzeb died in the year 1707. Dear student, previous line, repeat it again. Aurangzeb died in the year 1707. Aurangzeb issued a farman granting the company the right to trade duty free. Dear student, farman means a royal order. The company tried to press for more concession and manipulate exciting privileges. For trading purpose, the passes were issued to company officials, but they misused the pass for private trade and accumulate wealth on the name of company. Dear student, next topic now. How did trade lead to battles? After the death of Aurangzeb, the Bengal Nawabs asserted their powers and autonomy. Nawabs ruling Bengal after Aurangzeb, first Nawabs of Bengal, Murshid Quli Khan, and after Murshid Quli Khan, Ali Wardi Khan, after Ali Wardi Khan, Sirojuddullah. Sirojuddullah was the most powerful Nawabs of Bengal. They refused to grant the company concessions, denied it any right to mint coins, stopped from fortifications, and demanded large tribute to trades. The company refused to pay taxes, wrote disrespectful letters, and tried to humiliate the Nawabs and his officials. The dispute finally led to war between the company and the Nawabs. So after that, one battle of Plassey was begun. As the result of denial of trading rights on 23rd June 1757, Battle of Plassey was fought, and it was the first major victory of English in India. Ali Wardi Khan died in 1756 and Sirojuddullah became the Nawab of Bengal. Dear students, Sirojuddullah never wanted the East India Company to come here and do trade. So it was always against the East India Company. But in 1757, Robert Clive led the company's army against Sirojuddullah at Plassey. Robert Clive appointed governor of Bengal after some time in 1764. And in this battle, Sirojuddullah lost the battle. Because main reasons for defeat of the Nawabs was that the forces led by Mir Jafar. One of the Sirojuddullah commanders, betrayed Sirojuddullah and never fought the battles. Dear student, Mir Jafar was a military general who became the first dependent Nawabs of Bengal of the British East India Company. So, Mir Jafar was promised by Clive to be made Nawabs after crushing Sirojuddullah. As per the deal, Mir Jafar became the Nawab of Bengal after the defeat and death of Sirojuddullah. But he was the nominal head of Bengal, and actual power remained in the hands of British. After that, one more important battle between companies and Nawabs, the Battle of Buxar. After the defeat at Plassey, Sirojuddullah was assassinated and Mir Jafar was made the Nawab. Robert Clive led the company's army against Mir Kasib at Buxar. Mir Kasib lost the battle and company was given the Diwani right over Bengal. In 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the company as the Diwan of the provinces of Bengal, and they also got the Diwani right to Bihar and Odisha. Dear students, company officials becomes Nawabs. In 1764, Robert Clive was appointed governor of Bengal. In 1765, the mood of the company changed. Clive declared, "We must indeed become Nawabs ourselves." Nawabs, an anglicized version of the Indian word Nawab, as British were leading a levied life similar to Nawabs, and everyone was one of the mercy of British. So, in 1765, company got Diwani of Bengal's provinces. And the Mughal Emperor appointed the company as the Diwan of the provinces of Bengal, and they also got the Diwani rights of Bihar and Odisha. But after some times, Clive had now an opportunity of repeating in Hindustan or Upper India what he had accomplished in Bengal. In 1767, when Clive left India, his Indian fortune was worth 401 and 102. So he was crossed, examined in 1772 by the British Parliament, which was suspicious of his vast wealth. He was acquitted, but he committed suicide in 1774. Next point now, company rule expands. The company continued annexing Indian states from 1757 to 1857 through various policies. The company began interfering in the internal affairs of Indian states. First policies, subsidiary alliance. What is subsidiary alliance? According to this, Indian rulers had to keep company's army for protection and make their payments. If any rulers failed to pay, a part of their territories was taken as penalties. Awadh and Hyderabad were annexed through subsidiary alliance. So after that, Tipu Sultan, the Tiger of Mysore. Tipu Sultan was son of King Haider Ali and was a very strong ruler in the state of Mysore. In 1785, Tipu controlled the trade of Malabar coast and stopped the export of sandalwood, pepper and cardamom. He stopped local merchants to deal with British, employed French in his army in order to modernize his army. What happened next? Dear students, Tipu Sultan was against of company. So to suppress him, four wars were fought between Mysore and Britishers, famously known as Anglo-Mysore War. First war began 1767 and end in 1769, and second war 1780-84 and third 1790-92, and last war in 1799. In 1799, the Britishers won the Battle of Seringapatam against Mysore. Tipu Sultan was killed defending his capital, Seringapatam. So, after that, Vudiyars were now the new kings of Mysore.
Dear student, after that, war with the Marathas. In 18th century, company fought battle with Marathas. Three wars were fought between Marathas and British in 1782, second 1835 and third 1817-19. The third war was the decisive war, and after this Peshwa was deposed and sent to the northern India on a pension. Now the company had control over the south of Vindhyas. After that, now the claim to paramountcy. Under Lord Austin was Governor General from 1813 to 1823. A new policy of paramountcy was initiated. The company claimed that its authority was paramount or supreme. As British were proving themselves as the best power across the India, this enhanced their desire to rule all territories, and they started direct conquest under Lord Hastings. British also wanted to circumvent northwest front of their empire in India. For this, they fought war with Afghanistan, and company annexes part of Kittur. Kittur at present in Karnataka, Punjab, and finally on over its territories in 1843 and 1849 respectively. So dear students, Maharaja Ranjit Singh, please see in this picture, he was the Maharana Ranjit Singh. Maharana Ranjit Singh was the powerful rulers of Punjab. He did not allow company in Konkan region in Punjab, but in according this policy, he also defeated.
After that, one more policy, doctrine of lapse by the East India Company for Indian rulers. Under this reign of Lord Dalhousie, Governor General from 1848 to 56, they adopt the policy of lapse. According to this policy, the rulers who does not have any legal heir could not pass on their property to the adoption, and it would be taken over by British. According to this, Satara in
1848 Sambalpur, Udaipur, Nagpur, Jhansi and Awadh were annexed under this policy. So next, now company set up new administration. Dear students, after implementing the new policies, the East India Company established its empire on about 80% of the territory of India, after which they created the new administration according to East India Company. So now Warren Hastings was Governor General from 1773 to 1785, took few steps in setting up a new administration in India. He divided the British territories into administrative units called presidencies. There were three important presidencies, first Bengal, second Bombay and Madras. Bengal on north side of India and Bombay west side of India and Madras south side of India. So it was ruled by governor and the head of administration was Governor General. He also introduced changes in the sphere of justice. Each district was to have two important courts. So first important courts was criminal courts. Criminal courts called Fauzdari Adalat. According to this, it was under a Qazi and a Mufti. And next, civil courts. Civil courts called Diwani Adalat. According to this, Maulvis and Hindu Pandits interpreted Indian law for European. Under the Regulating Act of 1773, a new Supreme Court was established, while a Court of Appeal, the Sadar Nizami Adalat, was also set up at Kolkata. The entire system was supervised by the collector. Separate civil and criminal courts were set up under the supervision of collector. New setup of laws were compiled by Muftis and Brahmin for the religious interpretations. So after that, collector is most important post. So now next point, the company army. The company's army. Dear students, the company's army, it consisted of two types of soldiers. So after that, two types of soldiers according to East India Company, cavalry and infantry. Cavalry means sawars means soldier on horseback. According to this, all soldiers sitting on horseback. And second, infantry means paddle is Hindi words, paddle means soldiers on foot. According to this, all soldiers running and other soldier works by the foot. So dear students, welfare technology changed from the 1820. The company introduced new guns such as muskets and matchlocks. Muskets means it is a heavy gun used by infantry soldiers. Infantry soldiers, you know, also already paddle soldiers. And matchlocks means an early type of guns which the powder was ignited by the match. Now, it introduced a uniform military culture for Indian soldiers, which included European style training, drills and disciplines. Often this created problems since caste and community feelings were ignored in building a force of professional soldiers. This led to interpretations in the religions and communities' feeling of the soldiers, leading to their rebellion, such as the revolt of 1857 or the Sepoy Mutiny. Dear student, about the revolt of 1857, we will be read in chapter number 5. So, conclusions. The East India Company was transformed from a trading company to a territorial colonial power. So, you know about these pictures. Recapitulations. East India Company coming to India as traders. Begins trade in Bengal and gradually gains Nawabi. Annexations of territory by various policies, setting up a new administration, change in judicial setup, change in army, emerge as territory owners of colonial power. Dear students, in this way the British people who came to do trade in our country established their empire in our country, and the result of this was that India remained a slave of the British for many, many years. Now this chapter is over, dear students, and I hope this chapter is well understood by all of you. Thank you, dear students. And thank you for watching this video.